Welcome to psychiatric nursing lecture. So far we have seen many therapies, so we will have a little break and we will go and discuss some of the psychiatric disorders, and later we will discuss the remaining therapies which we have not covered. So firstly we are going to see about substance use disorders. So we know there are a lot of substances misused by different peoples in the world, and we are going to learn what kind of substances are commonly used for getting addicted, and we are going to see what kind of problems it will cause medically, and particularly what kind of problems it is going to cause psychiatrically, and also we are going to see how we are going to manage those problems and how we are going to treat those symptoms. So in a single lecture we cannot complete this unit, so we need at least 3 hours to complete this. So as much as possible I will try to simplify the concept so that you can learn very easily from the textbook. So let's see the introduction of this. So first you must know what is abuse or a substance abuse. So it is a pathological pattern of use of a substance such as drugs, an inability to control this use, and impairment in social or occupation functioning with a duration of abuse of at least a month. So any person who is using a drug for a long period, particularly more than 6 months, who cannot stop the drug for any purpose, because of this their social and occupation functioning are getting affected for at least 1 month period, so then we can say that person is a substance abuse person. So another definition given by Medline Medicals Encyclopedia clearly states that drug abuse is defined as the use of illicit drugs or the abuse of prescription or over the counter drugs for the purposes other than those for which they are indicated, or in a manner or in quantities other than directed. So we use various drugs, sometimes we use over the counter medications very frequently, or sometimes the illicit drugs, those drugs which are easily available in the market, particularly these are underground business, some drugs are available. So these drugs a person use and who cannot control the usage and who needs more amount in quantities to get the pleasure and satisfaction of those drugs, that peoples are called as drug abuse. Now let's see the common terms which we need to know in this unit. So drug dependence, drug abuse, these are the commonly we need to know. So drug dependence occurs when you need one or more drugs to function. For example, a person cannot do any of his day-to-day activities without taking drug, then we can say that person is under the dependence of some drugs. American Psychiatric Association used to distinguish between dependence and abuse. So many people use the term abuse and dependence in a similar way, but both are having difference. Abuse was considered the mild or early phase of inappropriate drug use. So the initial phase of misusing the drug or inappropriate usage of drug is called abuse. So abuse can lead to dependence. In the alphabet, A comes first, D comes later. So keep in mind that abuse is the initial stage of using a drug in a very mild amount, and dependence comes later. People with dependence have signs and symptoms different from those who are abused. Let's see the difference in both. The American Psychiatric Association replaced the term dependence and abuse with substance use disorder in the year 2013 edition of DSM-5. So the diagnosis for substance abuse disorder is involving the following criteria. Let's see the criteria which is diagnosing the substance use disorders. So nowadays we are not using the term dependence and abuse. Instead of that, we are using the term substance use disorders. So what is drug dependence? First, we are going to learn the difference between addiction and dependence. The addiction can occur without being a dependent on drugs. So all person who are having addiction cannot be a drug dependent. But drug dependent people may be a addicted person. For example, addiction involves using the drugs despite the consequences. We are using the drug by knowing the consequences of those drugs. Then we are addicted. Sometimes we are unable to stop using those drugs, which harm us, so that we are called as addicted. So because of this drug, we are avoiding the social responsibilities. Because of the drug, we are avoiding the social and work responsibilities. So they are also called as addicted. Now let's see who are all dependents. It is possible to be dependent on drugs without being addicted. Dependence can be bodily response to a substance. For example, when we have some disease conditions like hypertension, diabetes mellitus, glaucoma, so we are dependent on those drugs for our day-to-day living. So a person can be dependent on drug, but without being a addicted. But sometimes dependence involves the symptoms of addiction. Symptoms of addiction also seen in the dependence. For example, a person who takes antihypertensive drug, the same amount of drug may not give the therapeutic effect to reduce her blood pressure. So that time they may need additional dosage. Similarly, a person today who is taking just 2 ounces of alcohol to get the satisfactory effect, tomorrow he need more amount for getting those effects, pleasurable effects. So some of the people with dependence will have addiction symptoms also. So they develop high tolerance for the substance because the body adapts to the drug, and that leads to desire for using larger and more frequent doses of substances. Physical symptoms of withdrawal when you attempt to stop using the drug is commonly seen in dependent peoples. So this is about dependence and drug addiction. Now, some of the criteria for naming a person as a substance abuse client. First, they must craving to use the substances. They must repeatedly think about that substance, repeatedly search for that substance. And they should wanting to cut down or stop, but not to manage it. Those person who wants to stop taking the drug, but they could not do it. Another criteria is taking the substance in larger amount for longer to meet the needs. For example, today, a person gets satisfaction with 2 ounces of alcohol. The same amount in the future will not give the pleasurable feelings to him. So he needs more than 2 glasses of alcohol. So that is the thing. The next one is neglecting other parts of your life, like social functioning, interpersonal relationship, occupational functioning, everything you are avoiding because of that substance uses. Another criteria is continuously you are taking alcohol even though your personal life, the relationships are affected. And last thing is use of substance, even it puts you in some physical problems. Like many people who takes alcohol for long period knows that they have some problem in their liver or heart. Still, they took alcohol. So they are coming under substance abuse disorders. Now, let's see the common substances which are causing the abuse or causing the dependence. So firstly, heroin. Heroin has a high rate for causing substance abuse, followed by that alcohol, then cocaine, then barbiturates. Barbiturates usually calm down the central nervous system, so it's called downers. And we have nicotine. So these five substances are commonly causing abuse. So this I have written based on the severity in the descending order. So the other substances which can cause abuse problems are caffeine, opioids, hallucinogens, sedatives. So keep in mind these nine substances which causes abuse in a client. So first disease condition under this unit which we are going to see is alcoholism. So alcohol is in the form of ethyl alcohol or ethanol. So that is most intensively used by people for non-medical purpose. There is another type of alcohol, methyl alcohol, that is also called as methanol, but that is poisonous. Alcohol acts in the every cell of the body, but mainly it acts on the central nervous system. Alcohol affects the whole functions of our human body. Particularly, it affects our central nervous system functions. Because of that, our cognitive functions and motor behavioral functions also affected. So thought process, emotions, motor and behavioral activities also affected because of alcohol. The next one is single dose of alcohol will give effect the basic central nervous system depression effect. But that also changes our behavior. So a person lightly taking alcohol for the first time, we can able to notice that their walking pattern changes, their speech got distracted. So that you can note, and they've gone to the state of drowsiness. So this small amount can cause such problems. That is called intoxication effect. The effect of alcohol will depend upon the BAC, that is blood alcohol concentration. So in your blood, when you have more amount of alcohol, then you will exhibit more signs and symptoms. Severe problems will be exhibited by the client. So blood alcohol concentration tells in which level you are. So what is the definition of alcoholism by WHO? A chronic, a progressive, potentially fatal disorder. So alcoholism is a chronic condition. It is a progressive patient day to day increasing the amount of alcohol. The illness goes severely day to day. And potentially a fatal disorder marked by excessive and usually compulsive drinking. Compulsive, that is, the patient cannot stop drinking alcohol, purposefully, repeatedly doing drinking behavior. That leads to psychological and physical dependence or addiction. So this is about the definition of alcoholism. Another definition given by American Organization for Alcohol, it's a self-welfare group. Alcoholic Anonymous defines alcoholism as a physical condition associated with mental obsession. So the drinking is a physical activity which is related to our repeated thoughts of drinking, mental obsession. It is considered to be partly physical, partly psychological, partly sociological, and partly caused by the effect of alcohol. This problem is caused by various aspects of our health, like physical, social, psychological aspects along with the effect of alcohol. The effect of alcohol is CNS effect, CNS depressant effect. So next one is, what are the types of alcoholism? Basically, the types of alcoholism, there are 6 different types of alcoholism given by Jelinek in the year 1960. So based on that, the dividing the alcoholism into the people who are taking alcohol are divided into 6 types. One is alpha alcoholics. So it is the earliest stage when a person starts drinking. They start drinking the alcohol for relieving their day-to-day body pain and some kind of psychological pain. And these people who comes under alpha alcoholics can stop drinking. They can control their drinking pattern. And they are just psychological dependence. Whenever they feel sad, during that time only they go for alcohol. Whenever they feel emotionally labile, they are emotionally rejected by someone, then they go for alcohol. The second one is beta alcoholic. They are heavy drinker comparing to alcohol, that is alpha alcoholic. They drink daily and they have physical symptoms like tremors are seen in their body, but they are not addicted. Sometimes gastritis, physical symptoms, gastritis also seen, and they can quit alcohol very easily, but they don't have any withdrawal symptoms. They used to drink alcohol, but they can able to stop drinking alcohol for a long period of time. They don't have any physical, they are social dependent. They are not physical or psychological dependent. The third one is gamma alcoholic. These people have more severe than beta alcoholic. The loss of control in drinking. So they drink more amount of alcohol. They have physical dependence. So any activities to do steadily, they need alcohol. So that is physical dependence. And they can quit, and withdrawal symptoms are seen in these clients with gamma alcoholism. The fourth one is delta alcoholics. They have physical dependence, withdrawal symptoms are seen, they cannot quit alcohol. They constantly losing control over the amount of alcohol consumed. So day by day, they increase the amount of alcohol they are drinking. The fifth one is epsilon alcoholics. It is the final stage of alcohol. So here, they continuously drink alcohol. They have the binge drinking behavior. That is, every time they drink like small chips of alcohol, they used to ingest, and they cannot stop the thinking of taking alcohol. So every time they used to search for alcohol, where it is available, that is craving behavior and compulsive drinking. So even though they like every time they need to drink alcohol, compulsive, that is necessary, is there for them to drink alcohol for all time. There is another type of alcoholism, that is a sixth type, that is zeta alcoholics. So they are moderate drinker who becomes abusive and violent. So once they drink alcohol, they start doing physical abuse, sexual abuse, verbal abuse. They are also becoming more antisocial person. They exhibit more aggressive and violent behavior. So these are the types of alcoholism. Now let's see the etiology and risk factors of alcoholism. So mostly the hereditary pattern is commonly seen in the alcoholism. Studies suggest that 50% of alcoholics have alcoholic fathers and 30% of alcoholics have alcoholic brothers. So what is a social factor? So in the society, the alcoholism is growing very rapidly because of various social factors like peer influences. So during adolescent period, many of the adolescent children start taking alcohol. That is because of the friend's compulsion. And family and society influences. In some family, taking alcohol is not prohibited. So the younger generation also start taking alcohol in very young age. And society is allowing the people to drink alcohol, like social drinking is encouraged nowadays. And easy availability of alcohol. In every street, there will be one alcohol shop. And social status. Some people drink alcohol for the social power, to show their social status. And in some religious functions also, alcohols are available very easily. In the name of God, they drink alcohol. And because of this modernization, because of the westernization, and because of the influence of media, alcohols are easily ingested by many people. That is the social factors. Psychological factor. So when we have very severe amount of stress, when we have poor coping abilities, and sometimes alcohol is used as a reinforcement from other drinkers, and because of the curiosity, what will happen when we drink alcohol? So like that attitude makes a person to take alcohol. And psychiatric illnesses and other medical illnesses also force a person to take alcohol. For example, when a person is having severe medical problem, so to overcome those pain, they take alcohol. So these are the things. Some psychiatric problems, like those who have depression, those who have some kind of antisocial or narcissistic personality disorder, also take alcohol. The next one is the steady drinking over time. Some people regularly take alcohol, so that practice will become chronic, and later that will be converted into binge drinking behavior, and that will produce physical dependence. Once physical dependence is developed, these people cannot drink, they cannot leave the alcohol. Age is another important cause for drinking alcohol, because a person who start drinking alcohol in the younger age will become alcoholic very faster than the person who start drinking alcohol in the middle age. Family history is very closer risk factor for alcoholism. Many of the families with the history of alcoholism, like the parents or close relatives who had the alcoholism history, then their children also will have these problems in later stages of their life. And social imitation. So nowadays in the movies and in the advertisements, various actor, actress, sportspersons are encouraging for drinking alcohol by acting in the alcohol advertisement. So these are the risk factors. So easily an adolescent can catch that advertisement because they are thinking this actor, sportsperson, or as the role model, and they start following drinking alcohol very easily. So next important thing is about clinical features of acute alcohol intoxication. So in acute alcohol intoxication, these are the common signs and symptoms seen, like disinhibition, argumentativeness, aggression, lability of mood, impaired attention, impaired judgments, interference with personal functions, unsteady gait, difficulty in standing, slurred speech, nystagmus, decreased level of consciousness, most common. That is common, we can see the stupor and coma. The client can go for coma also when have severe intoxication of alcohol, and flushed face. So these are the signs and symptoms of acute alcohol intoxication. Next one is the chronic alcohol intoxication. Signs and symptoms, physical symptoms are evident, like tremors, and they will have the outstretched tongue, protruded trunk movements, eyelids, having some nystagmus, sweating, nausea or vomiting, tachycardia, hypertension, psychomotor agitation, headache, insomnia, malaise or weakness, transient visual, tactile or auditory hallucinations. These are psychotic features. Visual, tactile, auditory hallucination and illusions are psychotic features commonly present in chronic alcohol intoxication. And alcohol intake also leads to development of seizure, that is called grand mal convulsions commonly occur. So that is called rum fits or alcoholic seizures. So these are the signs and symptoms of chronic alcohol intoxication. So what are the alcohol related disorders? Most commonly psychiatric disorders occurs along with alcoholism, like anxiety, depressive disorder, psychotic disorder, organic brain syndromes like delirium, panic disorder, amnestic disorder, bulimia, post-traumatic stress disorder, borderline personality disorder. So people with alcoholism, they prone to develop these problems very easily. Now let's see the comorbid conditions. So a person who is having alcoholism or the person with this disease condition will have alcoholism. So existing of two problems in same patient, that is comorbid condition. So first one is antisocial or narcissistic personality disorder client, bipolar disorder client, schizophrenia, impulse disorder, attention deficit hyperactivity children's, physical or sexual assault victims and abuse and domestic violence victims. So can have alcohol problems very easily as their comorbid illness. Now one of the common psychiatric problem associated with alcoholism, we have many problems. So first problem we are going to discuss today is alcoholic amnestic syndrome. It is also called as Korsakoff syndrome, otherwise it is called as Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome. So what is Korsakoff syndrome? Korsakoff syndrome is a chronic memory disorder caused by severe deficiency of thiamine, vitamin B1. So a person who takes alcohol for longer period will have this complication called Korsakoff psychosis or Korsakoff syndrome or Wernicke psychosis. So here mainly misuse of alcohol for a long period of time leads to Korsakoff syndrome. During the period of illness, patient will have severe problem related to the cognitive impairment. So what are the causes of Korsakoff syndrome? Main causes include the body does not absorb the vitamin B1 thiamine effectively. Because of alcohol, this absorption is affected. So this leads to diminishes in the store level of thiamine in the liver, and because of this, the enzyme activity which converts thiamine into the active form is not produced. So that leads to Korsakoff psychosis or Korsakoff syndrome. So excessive amount of alcohol in our body will prevent the enzyme which converts the inactive thiamine into active thiamine. That's why the amount of thiamine in our body is decreased. That leads to various signs and symptoms called Korsakoff syndrome. So common signs and symptoms associated with Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome, WKS. First one is the person movement, physical movements are affected. They cannot have balance in their body posture. So they will have movement issues, that is called unsteady gait. Medically it is called ataxia. They also have confusion. Eye problems are common, like double vision, that is diplopia, ophthalmoplegia is more common. Drowsiness, fainting, rapid heartbeat, low blood pressure while standing are the other signs and symptoms. And lack of energy, peripheral neuropathy, impairment of memory, judgment, concentration and confabulation and labile mood are very common in the client with alcoholic amnestic syndrome, otherwise called as Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome. So what is the treatment? There is no specific treatment for Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome because the impairment is irreversible. We can prevent the further impairment by administering the thiamine. Thiamine is administered 50 to 100 milligram as a thiamine hydrochloride. So this can prevent the further damage. As a result of that, the thiamine deficiency can be corrected. Other supportive measures include general nutrition support, rehydration therapy, treatment for alcohol withdrawal, and treatment for alcohol withdrawal, we use the disulfiram therapy, you know very well, and also we go for rehabilitation and supportive therapies. So today class we have seen what are the difference between abuse, dependence, addiction. Also we have seen what are the substances causing alcohol, what are the substances causing dependence disorder, and we have seen the types of alcoholism. When we take alcoholism as a main topic today, we have seen the different types of alcoholism, the definition of alcoholism, the risk factors and etiology of alcoholism. Then we have seen the signs and symptoms associated with acute alcoholic syndrome and chronic alcoholic syndrome, the signs and symptoms. Then we have seen the problems caused by alcoholism. The first one is alcoholic amnestic syndrome, also called as Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome. And what are the signs and symptoms of Wernicke-Korsakoff syndromes and how we can manage it. So these things we have discussed. In another class, we will see the delirium tremens and the alcoholic seizure and other psychiatric disorders associated with substance associated with alcoholism. So still then, read this topic, and if you have doubt, you can clarify with me later. Take care. Bye bye. This is the end of part 1.